life of Jesus, or from incidences happening all around us, many of them are small gods today of their peoples, but sadly falling and among heroes tomorrow. Man's overvolting ambition, which takes away all humility and give man the first impression of his position, without me, the world will cease. My Lord and Savior did nothing of the sort. Even the judge who presided over his case, Pontius Pilate, also pleaded on his behalf. As we read in Luke 23, 13 to 16, and Pilate, when he had called together the chief priests and the rulers and the people, said unto them, "You have brought this man unto me as one that perverted the people. And behold, I, having examined him before you, I found no fault in this man, touching those things whereof you accuse him. No, nor yet Herod, for I sent you to him, and lo, nothing worthy of death is done unto him. I will therefore chastise him and release him." Prophet Isaiah foresaw and prophesied all the sufferings that the Messiah, when he arrived, would fulfill more than 400 years before he came. Prophet Isaiah was a prophet during the reign of Hosea, the king of Israel, and Hezekiah, king of Judah, the great-grandson of King David. Despite the royalty of Jesus, his attributes as the Prince of Peace, the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, and the Lamb of God, he demonstrated that humility even to the cross, so that you and I could gain everlasting life. Amen?
Amen.
If all leaders, irrespective of what capacity you are asked to serve, have learned lessons from the life of the Lord and emulated his servant leadership example, our lives today in the world will have been more fulfilled in our homes as a father. If you are not humble, you cannot have an understanding heart or a listening ears to have any communication with your wife and children. Lack of humility brings a false sense of pride and illusion that they cannot survive without me. The opinion of your wife, your children, your friends do not usually count as long as you have made up your mind. As a wife, because I have a good job, I have a good family, I'm highly educated, and I can secure any job when I wish, I don't have to stoop for any man, not even my husband. Because your husband says one thing, before you say one thing, you are replied with two or three counter words. Civil or cordial communication within the family always results in avoidable argument. With you as a wife trying to intimidate him to submission of your own wish, right or wrong, whichever way. All this cat and mouse relationship and the drama should not be demonstrated in the presence of your children, your words, your friends of the family, and those who are looking up to you for leadership. If you disrespect your husband openly at the slightest provocation, you should not be surprised if he is disrespected by his children and words, because you have failed in your responsibility as a wife and mother. The Bible says in Ephesians 5:21-23, submit yourselves to one another in the fear of God. Wives, submit yourselves unto your own husbands, as unto the Lord, for the husband is the head of his wife, even as Christ is the head of the church, and he is the Savior of the body. The Bible is more emphatic on the roles of mothers to the family, because as the saying goes, the hands that rock the cradle rules the world. Many good leaders today and presidents have never stopped praising their mothers for the primary role they play in their life. They say, "Whatever I am today, I owe it to my mother, or I owe it to my wife." Behind every successful man, there is a woman. Can your children say that of you today? Search your conscience. Behind the success of every man, there is usually a woman. And what does the Bible reveal concerning this woman of honor? which every woman should strive to emulate and copy. We find out one in Proverbs 31, 10 to 29. An excellent wife, who can find? For her worth is far above jewels. The heart of her husband trusts in her, and he will have no lack of gain. She does him good and not evil. All the days of her life, verses 26 to 28, she opens her mouth in wisdom, and the teaching of kindness is on her tongue. She looks well to the ways of her household, and does not eat the bread of idleness. Her children rise up and bless her. Her husband also, and he praises her, saying, many daughters have done nobly, but you excel them all. And also in Ephesians 5, 28 to 30, the Lord has a mandate too for all husbands. So husbands ought to also to love their own wives as their own bodies. He who loves his own wife loves himself. For no one ever hated his own flesh, but nourishes and cherishes it, just as Christ also does the church, because we are members of his body. Amen. Jesus' attitude of servanthood was in direct contrast to that of the disciples, who had recently been arguing among themselves as to which of them was the greater. Luke 22, 24, and there was also a strife among them, which of them should be accounted the greatest. Since there was no servant present to wash their feet, it would never have occurred to them to wash one another's feet. When the Lord himself stooped to this lowly task, they were stunned into silence. To his credit, though, Peter was profoundly uncomfortable with the Lord washing his feet and never been at a loss for words. Peter protested, "You shall never wash my feet." Then Jesus said something that must have further shocked Peter. "Unless I wash your feet, you have no part with me." Amen. Prompting Peter, whose love for the Savior was genuine, to request a complete washing. Then Jesus explained the true meaning of being washed by him. Peter has experienced the cleansing of salvation and did not need to be washed again in the spiritual sense. Salvation is a one-time act of justification by faith, but the lifelong process of sanctification is one of washing from the stain of sin we experience as we walk through the world. Every day we sin, and every day we undergo that process of sanctification whenever we come to repentance. Peter and the disciples, all except Judas, who never belonged to Christ, needed only this temporal cleansing. The word servant in Matthew 20, 27 means slave. Not every servant was a slave, but every slave was a servant. What we are witnessing in churches today is very demoralizing, as many worshippers seeing themselves as celebrities who feel that they are patronizing God by sparing their precious time to come to church, and hence are always so impatient for the service to end, even though they see within the 2.5 hours allotted to Christ in a week. There are many who want to exercise authority, as we read in Matthew 20, 25, but few who want to take the towel and basin and wash feet. Amen. Apostle Paul reminds us that our attitude is to be like Christ, in that we should endeavor to consider others better than ourselves, and do nothing out of vanity or selfishness. Rather, we look out for the interest of others. Philippians 2, 3 to 4. Do nothing from selfishness or empty conceit, but with humility of mind, regard one another as more important than yourselves. Do not merely look out for your own personal interests, but also for the interests of others. Have this attitude in yourselves, which was also in Christ Jesus. Amen. By so doing, it will make every Christian a servant of Christ and others. Primarily, the focal point of servant leadership within the church is to prepare God's people for works of service, so that the body of Christ may be built up. Ephesians 4:12. This means, with Christ being the head of the church, the entire church body is served in the act of providing leadership. It's not just church leaders who become acutely aware of their place at the foot of the cross, but all those within the body of Christ. We all mutually submit ourselves to Jesus, just as he was in submission to the Father. From a biblical perspective, servant leadership is not only being free of abuse of power or coercion, but it's first and foremost based on mutual respect and love for one another. A servant leader seeks to invest himself into the lives of his people so that as a whole, the church community is challenged to grow to be more like Christ. And this is demonstrated in their willingness to give of themselves to meet the needs, but not necessarily the wants of their people. Like a good parent, the true servant leader knows the difference between spiritual needs of his children and their selfish wants and desires. In other words, a good leader must develop an understanding heart. The bottom line to the application of servant leadership is that we should not emulate the example of the world. Our example is Jesus, who came as a servant. Therefore, our mission is to serve one another and to give of ourselves. Christ came to give his life. We are to give off our lives not only in service to him, but to our fellow man, including those in the church and outside the church. As we also read in Mark 12:31, and the second is like, namely this, thou shalt love thy neighbor as thyself. There is no other commandment greater than this. This truth is just one of several from this incident that Christians can apply to their own lives. First, when we come to Christ for the washing of our sins, we can be sure that it is permanent and complete. No act can cleanse us further from our sin, as our sin has been exchanged for the perfect righteousness of Christ on the cross. 2 Corinthians 5:21. For he hath made him to be sin for us, who knew no sin, that we might be made the righteousness of God in him. Amen.
Amen.
But we do not need a continual cleansing from the effects of living in the flesh in a sin-cursed world. The continual washing or sanctification is done by the power of the Holy Spirit who lives within us through the washing of water by the word of God, given to us to equip us for every good works. And we also read in 2 Timothy 3:16-17, all scriptures is given by inspiration of God, and is profitable for doctrine, for reproof, for correction, for instruction in righteousness, that the man of God may be perfect, thoroughly furnished unto all good works. It is at this point we can see ourselves as being born again, and what do we experience? How is the pattern of our lives when we are born again? Being a born-again Christian means you have become a new creation in Christ. Christianity is not a modification. Christianity is not an improvement. It is not a purification of your old life. It is receiving a completely new life, the life of Christ in exchange for your old sinful life that was executed on the cross of Christ. This is what the Bible means by the experience of conversion or regeneration. The moment you experience the new path, you pass from death to life and from condemnation of the law to justification unto life. Amen.
Amen.
This is the beginning of the Christian walk. Now that you have the life of Christ through The indwelling of the Holy Spirit, your goal in life must be to manifest that life so that all may see Christ in you.
Amen.
The work of subduing the sinful desires of the flesh and reproducing the holy and righteous life of Christ in you is the work of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
This work is the process of sanctification. And while this experience of sanctification does not contribute one iota towards your title to heaven, it witnesses the salvation you have already received in Christ through justification by faith. Hence, sanctification is the fruit of the Spirit. It's witnessing through justification by faith all the power of the gospel. But for this to happen, you must learn to walk in the Spirit. In Adam, all you are capable of was to walk in the flesh, satisfying the drives of the sinful nature that is seeking after worldly material things, which in the Bible termed treasures. But now, as a born again,